The rest of the day was a day like any other, until a series of events began when James once again found Ned Skimble teasing Charles. James, seeing red and wishing to protect his friend, scared Ned away by projecting an air of toughness and malice without actually harming him. James used a gesture he had often seen on TV. He pointed two fingers at his own eyes and then pointed one finger at Ned Skimble. Then, in his best tough guy Scottish accent, he said,
"I'm looking at you, pal."
"Oh, don't worry about me," said Charles. "He'll only go so far because he knows I'm related to the owner of this factory. But he's a nuisance and a constant reminder of why I hate it here. I should be in school." "It's very caring of your factory-owning relative to let you work here." "And it's very caring of my mother to make me work here too," Charles replied bitterly. "Ah, well," said James, "only another hour to go." A little later, James was returning downstairs with a basket containing jars of liquid shoe polish. He noticed Ned Skimble whispering to Jack, his elder brother, before darting off to the other side of the room. James paid the two boys little attention and collected some more jars from Christopher Timkins before continuing to the racks where he would stack them. Then, suddenly, someone tripped him. James stumbled, trying not to drop his load, but he failed and he crashed to the ground. Alerted by the sound of breaking glass, Mr. Tugbury came rushing out of the office and stomped down the stairs.
"What?" roared Tugbury.
"He's plain clumsy, he is," piped up Jack Skimble.
"You tripped me," accused James, getting to his feet.
"No, I didn't. You ought to watch where you're going."
Tugbury ignored them both and studied the basket, silently counting the broken jars. His lips moved as he counted.
"I won't have it. I tell you, I won't stand for it," he cried, turning to look fiercely at James. "I am cross. I am very, very cross. You, boy, are sacked, and you won't be getting no wages either on account of paying for these breakages."
"That's not fair," protested James.
"If my brother said he was tripped, then he was tripped," asserted Robert, now at his brother's side. Tugbury wasn't a tall man. His battered top hat was on a level with Robert's eyes. Robert couldn't prevent the impulse, and with a slow and deliberate flick, he knocked Tugbury's hat off.
"I won't stand for it," cried Tugbury, bending down to pick up his hat.
His rotund belly meant that this was quite a slow manoeuvre. Before he had a chance to rise, James picked up a jar of liquid shoe polish. Before Tugbury could replace his hat, James proceeded to pour the black liquid on top of his bald head. Then James and Robert looked at each other, burst out laughing, and in a routine worthy of Laurel and Hardy, they danced their way out of the factory, leaving Tugbury polish dripping down the side of his face in stunned silence.